You don't remember him hanging that low. That's what they first did here. Wow. Witter shins.
Witter shins.
Expressions on the faces of the stunning millions, the power of the town, the fuel that drives the clan. He's the motive and the conscience of the murderer. He's a preacher on TV, the false sincerity, the fun that had it driven by the big computers and nuclear bombs, the kids with no bombs, and I'm fearful that he's inside me. Exercising his authority. We've got the American Jesus bolstering national faith. We've got the American Jesus overwhelming millions every day. Yeah.
Stellar Corpses. Woo! On Witter Shins.
Witter Shins.
We're here. The Misfits for that. Or actually Misfits.
And Bad Religion.
And Bad Religion at the beginning of that. I've often wondered which punk band first coined the term Hollywood Babylon? Who first used it in a song? And the Misfits predate...
Somebody before the Misfits used it?
The Damned.
Oh, okay.
Damned used it. Okay. Plan 9, Channel 7. Okay. But Misfits are old enough that it could be a competition. But now that here we are at Wiedersheim's Tower in the heart of Hollywood, since I've been tripping around Hollywood for, a year and a half?
What, since we've moved back to
LA?
Yeah. Yeah, about a year and a half.
I've noticed something. Because, I am a lifelong pagan and I like, studying old, obscure, archaic shit. I have noted that here in Hollywood, most of the major landmarks in Hollywood are adorned with carvings of Babylonian gods. Even at the park where my kid plays, where Marta played when she was a kid, I don't know if those statues were still there, but Babylonian gods, statues of Babylonian gods in the park. I mean, they have a Jewish memorial, a little Holocaust too. There's other stuff in the park, but just tucked off to the sides, everywhere in this town, Babylonian gods. Now, I don't know really if the punks were thinking that far into it, but prophecy. Prophecy, brothers and sisters. They were ahead of their time. They're right. They're right. We're worshiping Babylonian gods here. I don't care. Well, I have been spared a lot of horrific Trump news today because Marta's been busy playing this game on Facebook where you change band names by like one letter, and she's been fucking it up for the rest of the world. She's come up with like 20,000 different hilarious band names, but you know they're running out of bands. Nobody can do anything.
I feel craptastic today. So I just have to amuse myself for the day and then, like, laugh and stuff. Yeah.
And then that wasn't enough for her. She wanted to take a challenge a step higher, and then she started coming up with albums. And the one that like, I'm still busting up about is...
James Frown. I feel bad.
So she's been a barrel of laughs today, and yeah, it's just fucked that game up for everybody else because she's used like all of the bands that there are probably.
The Manberries.
The latest one, 45's Grave.
Yep.
I don't know if any of y'all would get that. It's funny as fuck though. But don't get that. The FBI will come visit you, man. Wittershins.
We're
in the middle of here in this town. We just had the Emmys. Important
like
time.
Yesterday we had the Emmys.
But apparently it's not really close to our house because the traffic didn't get fucked up.
It was at the Apple Theater?
Yeah.
The Mac Theater?
Staples Center or something.
No, it wasn't at the Staples Center. It was at something by the Staples Center.
Yeah.
And I think the Staples Center is downtown.
I think it's downtown LA.
It's not going to affect our personal traffic much.
Yeah, but then the Academy Awards is going to come up and the entire town shuts down around here.
I don't know what that's going to be like.
It's at the Dolby Theater.
Yeah.
Where all the Babylonian gods are.
Where the Hollywood Walk of Fame is,
yes.
Obviously.
They right have behind the Hollywood Walk of Fame, the back entrance to the Dolby Theater, Babylonian gods as tall as buses carved into the very structure. And I totally agree with that. So, Marta.
Yeah.
Are you a Wiccan?
No.
Yeah, me neither. And that's the title of the show, Witchcraft Without Wicca. And I have been working on a series that I'm going to do through my Gumroad site on this very subject and an entirely... non-Wiccan system of witchcraft. Because even the my old classes that I taught years ago, you know, it's rampant with Wiccan stuff. We don't really practice it like Wiccans, but a lot of the stuff's the same. It's the stuff that I grew up with. It's just time to step it up in the world because this has been going on for quite a while. The entire time that I've had my witch store, and it was going on before that at the witch store that I was working at in Santa Cruz, the first one that opened, 13 Rio Magic, and a huge parting of the ways with Wicca and witchcraft, which used to be for most of my lifetime and most of your lifetimes synonymous with each other. Wicca is how witches have religious rights, and I'll give them that credit. But it has been, you know, when people would, you know, say the word witches for you know, a couple decades now, people would correct them and say, "You mean Wiccans," and that pretty much was the right answer most of the time because Wicca was the dominant force. I happen to come from a weird old tradition. It was around before Wicca, but when Wicca was the dominant force, they adopted the dominant force. There are trends in the world and in spirituality and in religion. I'm not suggesting that you ever follow trends, but some you have to. Some are so large, it becomes the way of the land. And I'm a rebel. But rebels tend to lose. Not everybody wants to do that. Not everybody wants to throw their throw themselves against the status quo. Sometimes you got to go along with the status quo. So the majority of the witchcraft that existed prior to Wicca taking over absorbed Wicca into it, which I've always thought fascinating because I always said, you know, Wicca is a religion that absorbed witchcraft into it. And I just said this the other day on this some new page we're on. What is it? Pagans and Wiccans? Or Wiccans and Pagans?
Witches and... I don't think Wiccan...
I thought it was Wiccan. No, I think it's Wiccans, yeah. I think it's Pagans and Wiccans, I think.
Those people are those so people. Special.
Yeah. Well, you know, okay, so I'm on a... I'll give them their credit. You know, I'm on a site called Pagans and Wiccans, I think it is, and I go and broach this argument. So, of course, it's going to cause problems. But somebody asked if anybody had transitioned from Wicca into... into other religions, yeah. Or other paths. She said religions, and I said, I left Wicca for witchcraft. Does that count? That's all I said. But, you know, your Uncle Birch, Hollywood warlock, courts controversy without even fucking trying. It was a very simple statement that resulted in 200 and some odd comments on this thread. There's no other discussion on this thread.
Busted out the pitchforks. Yes. As soon as he said, I left Wicca for witchcraft. That's it. That's all he said. And it was just nonstop all day. And then finally the moderator was like, okay, guys, let's move along.
Yeah. Well, the moderator tried to shut it down, then people didn't stop, and then late in the game, somebody chimes in and goes, hey, there's some other Hollywood witches. I'm living here in West Hollywood.
We
ended up friending each other and having a good old time, and the post kind of fell apart. You know, at that point, you know, all these people had attacked me all day long and into the next day.
And they were, like, talking shit about me. You know, like... They demanded all these answers from him, and I'm sorry, he's working. He was, like, at a reading, and they just kept baiting him, and saying, why aren't you answering? So finally, I was like, he's working. So now they're like, oh, he sent mommy in to defend him.
I wasn't even on it. And then when I heard her going off about it, I had to step away from work and respond to some of these twits on this fucking page. A huge portion of the debate right at that point, two or three people just kept badgering on, was demanding to know my lineage.
Yeah.
And that pissed me off. You don't fucking demand to know anybody's fucking lineage. I grew up in the Druidic craft of the wise. And within the Druidic craft of the wise, like we view pagan now, it was this big umbrella. It had this weird mythos that was only the Druidic craft of the wise. Nobody had anything like that. But that was really kind of a sideline within the Druidic craft of the wise. I came to know Strega and go through an entire tradition of Strega. I came to be a Gardnerian initiate. I came to be an outer circle member of the OTO within the Druidic craft of the wise. It was just, there was all this other stuff going on, and the Druidic craft of the wise West Coast was a little less weird than our parent organization off in the Ozarks or the Appalachians, up in some backwards sticks mountains somewhere in Kentucky, I think. Kentucky. Different than that. But under the Druidic craft of the wise, I came to know all these other traditions. And within the tradition of the Druidic craft of the wise, there was clergy of all these other traditions. And we eventually, the Druidic craft of the wise absorbed a group of Gardnerians. And then from that point on, it was Gardnerian magic. It was the basic Gardnerian rituals done in the Gardnerian fashion, though I didn't, you know, specifically consider myself a Gardnerian. I was a practitioner of Gardnerian ways through the Druidic craft of the wise, which has nothing to do with Druidism. And that was part of the problem with that whole tradition. They chose a very unfortunate name that was very confusing. It really had nothing to do with Druidic anything. I can't explain why they did that, but whatever. So I said DCW, and challenge them to, you know, go fucking Google it. Go Google DCW. You'll find you'll probably find a horrible thing that Isaac Bonowitz wrote about the founder of the DCW. You know, the ones back in the Ozarks or the Appalachians or wherever they are in the hills of fucking Kentucky. Yeah. It's a horrible thing that I thought was hilarious, witty, well-written. Loved Bonowitz even when he was bashing on the grandmaster of my parent tradition. I didn't fucking care. Had nothing to do with me. The grand old men of witchcraft always had really cool stories about them and outlandish tales about their evil deeds. Eli from the Druidic Craft of the Wise was no different. He had those same kind of stories, and I don't hold any of that against him. I wasn't there. But these people demanding my lineage pissed me off to where then, I just would not answer.
The one time I said he's at work, and so then they attacked me, that he sent mommy, all this stuff. And then this one chick goes, I'm cracking up that his wife doesn't know his lineage. And I'm like, I'm cracking up that you think it's my job to tell you my husband's lineage. And she shut the fuck up right after that.
My wife, a high priestess in the Druidic Craft of the Wise, with, that sprang two covens and several other work groups. If we were full gardenerians, man, she'd have a couple buckles in her garter. Damn, that's hot. I always liked that part. You know, Janet Ferrar's,
less to look at.
I should with buckles. With some buckles. And, yeah. What the fuck am I talking about? Oh, we got a scourge.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's a proper scourge, but it worked for me.
Yeah.
Anyway, TM fucking I. You guys distracting me. I'm trying to tell a fucking story because I come from the Bardic school of the Druidic Craft of the Wise. And the story is what's important. It's not even accuracy of the story. It's the flavor, the color, the rhythm, the flow of the story. And my flow got fucked up, so I'm flowing back into it. So these people were demanding my lineage and just the audacity.
They were just gnarly.
The audacity of the approach made me refuse to answer, pissing many people off. They went on and on. They're still demanding my fucking lineage.
And then somebody posted your thing for Hexfest and gave you a free plug. And then somebody else copied and pasted your entire bio the page.
Yes,
and
yes,
I'm like, okay,
yes,
bitches.
Yes, he's fucking on this new page where, you know, they barely have an initiation between them. The athletes opinionated assholes. We met some cool people there. There's some cool people there. I'm just talking about the assholes, and there are several there. But I'm new on the page, so I always get to know those people and fuck with those people and piss them off. Maybe eventually get kicked off the page, but sometimes I've gotten other people kicked off the page too. The demands of these assholes made me refuse their demands to piss them off because this is one of the things I laid out. I got some problems with the Wiccan read, but we'll go into that later. But this, self-appointed authority figures within Wicca using their authority on other people from other groups and other people that are not even in groups as if they had such authority. This is why people are turning from Wicca to witchcraft. In addition to these other things. And this is one of the reasons I do that. Now, mind you, I am an elder in my tradition. If I want to fucking wave my cord around and wave my authority over fucking people, I could do that all day, every day. And guess what? It's not hard to fucking do. That's why it doesn't thrill me. It's not a challenge to be a cult leader. I could do it tomorrow. Plenty of people I could get to follow. I don't want it. I don't like those types of people. I've said it a million times in my courses. If I find you blindly following me, I will lead you halfway down a trail that leads to a cliff and disappear when you look back for guidance. Don't be a blind fucking follower. That's not a witch. Maybe that's a Wiccan. It shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. It never was supposed to be. All these people want to hearken back to Gerald Gardner and now say he owns Wicca. And unless you did things his way, you're not Wiccan. Guess what? He didn't want any of that shit. Like Jesus didn't want what became of Christianity. Gardner didn't put forth this dogma. Gardner didn't put forth these rules. Gardner did not put forth this control. And if all the BTW wants to hearken back to him as their founder, well, guess what? The people you got representing your founder have fucked it all up. You become an organized religion. Wicca was not supposed to be an organized religion. Most people left organized religion to join Wicca. We used to call them converted Catholics back in my day because for some reason we had more Catholics converted over to Wicca than from any other religious sect. Maybe now I know why, because Catholicism absorbed so much witchcraft, it made it really fucking easy to do. But these self-appointed authority figures, they're authority figures in their little fucking realm, in their little fucking covenant, I'm an authority figure in my realm, and my realm's bigger than your fucking realm, and I don't think it's okay to wield such authority over people. I took my tradition, the Druidic craft of the wise, tweaked it into the Circle A system of magic. The very name Circle A indicates anarchy. We may have some leaders, but we don't have rulers. The cord system that was... Yes, okay, MARTA rules. Other than that, no rulers. But the cord system that I grew up on in the Druidic craft of the wise became the same color scheme for the same ranks. But instead of rank and privilege, it was shit you climbed through to reach that rank and responsibilities you then took on having taken on that rank. It was a symbol of that. It wasn't something to wield over people saying, oh, I'm a priestess and you're not. You're a neophyte and I'm not. I'm the ruler. No, and you know, I'm sorry. I hope it doesn't piss off people. I try not to say it in too offensive a way. The people that do that, historically, in my entire time, and I got a lot longer in the craft than most of you fucking people listening to this, but all the way back to the early fucking 80s, the people that do this, the priestesses that do this, the ones that rule their coven like that, you can clearly see just looking at them, they have no control over their lives or their hygiene. Those people want to control others. They've found this little realm where, oh, I have this little coven and I can be a bee priestess and rule them all. And everybody else in the world hates me because I'm a scumbag and I have no self-control in my life. And nobody's going to love me. But I'm going to make all these people respect me by being their little ruler in the coven.
Especially the ones who are prettier than me.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially the ones who aren't as pretty as Marta. They really wanted to. No, I remember a woman coming to me and she wanted to drum out a member of our tradition because she believed that the other woman was shallow and only thought about clothes and makeup.
Oh, you told me this story.
Yeah.
We know her.
Yeah, and okay, she was good looking. And the one complaining was not.
She is not stupid.
No.
That's the thing.
No.
She's not stupid.
No.
And this woman was trying to convince herself of something that didn't exist.
Yes. No, she's still a friend of ours here in Hollywood.
Yeah.
And I said, well, you know, she may be interested in those things, but for some reason, when it comes to speaking on spirituality, she waxes. She has a lot to say. She goes deep. She comes from another realm that is different than her normal exterior presence. It's like, that's witchcraft. Jesus, people. Not
she wears makeup.
Exactly.
I wear makeup.
The person that was complaining did not wear makeup and was not what you would consider good looking by the regular standards of society, shall we say. Yes. And that's fine. You know, you can be who you are. You know, some people have, you know, weight problems, or some people have, you know, self-esteem problems. But to try and take down somebody that doesn't have those within a religious context, no, as priest, no, it was not that kind of party, and it would not be that kind of party under my watch.
Do you remember all the people who came up to you with their quote-unquote concerns?
Oh,
when we started dating?
Oh, yes. Well,
same thing.
There you go. Dogma and Rules. Early on, you know, way back, you know, I think I was married at the time, and I hadn't even heard of non-monogamy, so it was way before all that fucking shit. But they came up with these rules in my tradition that teachers shall not sleep with students. That was the sentence. And I said to them, I said, okay, I see where you guys are trying to go here. It sounds like you're doing a statement of intent. A brief statement of intent never covers the intent. You cannot have a brief statement of intent and truly establish your intent. It will not work magically. It will not work in a magical group either. The intent is to not let people of a higher rank use that rank to manipulate people lower than them. That's the problem.
And they didn't even know that I was brainwashed.
Now, hold on. Let me lay this out before you start talking about that. That's the intent. And I, you know, those of you that don't know, I was a cop one time. And I remember in the academy studying a very important thing. It was the difference between the spirit of the law and the letter of the law. And the spirit of the law carried precedence. It's what was the law trying to achieve? What was it trying to address? That's why you don't just enforce everything against everybody if it's not really addressing that problem. Now, the problem was that people using this given authority over people that didn't have authority to manipulate them against their will into sexual encounters and that kind of stuff, and the craft and Wicca and everything was rampant with it, but it doesn't address the problem. You're trying to use a small band-aid on a big problem. Nothing heals under a band-aid. What you need to do is be training your clergy not to want to rule people against their will, not to want to have sex with people that are being ruled against their will. I know that. I did that. I learned how to, and it wasn't really that hard, but I learned a long time ago how to reprogram myself. And before I reprogrammed myself, you sure wouldn't hear me on a fucking podcast every week. You wouldn't see me talking to anybody. You'd be hiding. Be this little gothy-looking kid before there was a goth, hiding in a corner, scared of people because I was a freak. I reprogrammed myself. People can be reprogrammed. We can program. If we'd spent more time working on our clergy and making our clergy better clergy, like the Catholic Church should have been doing, then we'd really address the problem. Then we'd maybe really have healing in our communities, but nobody's ever done that. That kind of rule stands to this point. And people brought that shit up when me and Marta started going out.
People are trying to come from a place where, like, you know, she's your student, you're her teacher, it's not right. But it's like, the only reason you even liked me in the first place is because I dominate you.
Well,
at times.
You had not dominated me at that time, but however, you were clearly such a hard-headed lass that you could not be easily or ever manipulated against your will. That was clear, and I find that attractive. Maybe I programmed myself not to find the other things attractive. I don't know which came first, the chicken and egg, but as far back as I know, I like strong women. And yeah, you know, they say a lot of shit about your mother, you know, and psychological shit. It's like, my mom was a gutsy, gutsy woman. And she clashed heads with authority figures when things were unjust. And maybe that's where it came from. I don't know. But I don't like waifs, damsels in distress. Whatnot. So Marta here, she could never be ruled against her will. And we had already pretty much established a relationship. And they're not sexual yet. But we were like hanging out every day, like all day. And my coworkers were kind of getting pissed off that I wasn't getting any work done. Before she even knew who was teaching that class she signed up for.
Yeah.
Okay, I knew.
Yeah, and then, I showed up and I saw you and I said, what are you doing here? I was really surprised to see you.
Yeah.
And then you told me you were teaching it.
I like to surprise you, honey.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, these kinds of things, Wicca's been around so long, it develops these dogmas, and these faction fights, and these power trips that go on. And, you know, there's a whole lot of fucking traditions in Wicca. And they may not correspond to your BTW or whatever you fucking got, but nobody ever gave any of you the right to come over into somebody else's pond. I got sidetracked before. I was talking about the DCW, and a huge part of the DCW mythos was how to disguise and hide, and everybody had to use only their witch name, and nobody could speak of the houses from whence they came. So, coming from that tradition, you demanding my lineage, I got a problem with that. And the reasons I recall in the old Book of Shadows for that was for fear of cowards and eavesdroppers. Traitors, for lack of a better word. I don't have to answer to any of that, and the audacity of thinking that I do. Somebody looked up my entire bio, you know, people that, yeah. that, you know, have a day job and, you know, wish they had my life. Have this whole thing about me and the store and the podcast and the YouTube channel and all my years of experience. And they're like posting that like it's a bad thing.
Yeah, like check this out. Yeah,
plugging Hexfest on a place where I'm not allowed to plug Hexfest. Being a presenter at Hexfest, I have agreed to advertise Hexfest on my social media, which we did anyways. We did last year's Hexfest. Nobody asked us to do that. But we did that. So now, these people are meeting, you know, over meeting my obligations for me by posting it on places where I'm not allowed to post it. And actually, they should have gotten in trouble for advertising because that was not the advertising thread. And had I done that, a bunch of bee priestesses would have come down upon me.
And we made a friend.
This
was so everybody
shut up once we made a friend.
Going off. And then this one guy goes, Michael Carell, and like tags him, and he's like, I've been looking at more Hollywood witches from the DCW, and like he's all excited, and I'm all excited, and I sent him a friend request, and we like totally started our own conversation, and that's when the moderator stepped into that other page and was like, okay, let's move along.
Yeah, I think him calling us homies was the last thing. Everybody just went away. They were so pissed off right then.
Yeah.
Nobody made any homies on that thread. But this kind of thing went on before there was an internet. And now that we have an internet, we have self-appointed authority figures all over the fucking place. People that become high priestess after a year and a day. You know what? That's fucking weak. And I know of BTW groups where that is the case. And I'm sorry. While the DCW did adopt gardenerian practices, it wasn't weak enough to where we let them be a high priestess in a year and a day. No, you're an initiate in a year and a day. You're a teacher in 2 years and 2 days. You're a priestess in 3 years and 3 days. On and on and on and on it goes. You're a high priestess for quite a while. So those that posted my bio and challenged the fact that I was a high priest by 18, well, you didn't do the math. I was officially involved by 13. Back then, there was different standards. Back then, people still were worried about your parents suing them, but I, quite frankly, was an emancipated minor. I had been a latchkey kid for at least 5 years before that. I was on my own. I lived at my mom's house, but she pretty much had no control over me because she worked all the time. Thanks, Mom, for giving me that freedom. But as such, I was able to get involved in this tradition at an earlier age than anybody can in this day and age because everybody's afraid of getting sued. Sorry, suck it. You don't like it? Suck it. You weren't there. You weren't there in the early 80s. It was a different time. There were certain kids at 13 years old that had an awakening that they were looking for. And that lasted for a couple decades. There were certain kids around that age that they were looking for, and I happened to fit the mold. And then one day, I'm sitting in my shop in Santa Cruz, and this young upstart lad comes in, and he asked me if I can make, it was an incense recipe that I know is the Eye of the Cat's recipe.
And I said,
it was a thieves thing. Okay. But the language was specifically theirs, and I said, well, you know, I do have the recipe, but I won't make other people's stuff for it. I could make, you know, my version of that kind of thing. And then this kid starts to tell me the story of how he grew up in the back of this witch store in Long Beach. And he learned the craft by making incense in the back room. And then eventually they moved him out into the side room and he was making oils. And then they moved him out and he was teaching classes. And then he was, you know, leading a coven. And I was like, looking at this. And then he says the words. It's like the Eye of the Cat in Long Beach. And I just go, this fucking kid just walked in here and told me my life story. Turned out to be true. Turned out he was the next one. He was the next 13-year-old special child that they were looking for, and he was the next one in line after me. I went through. I got it up, you know, my late 20s, and then left the area and started my own, you know, offspring, you know, as you know, elsewhere. But you know, now we're back in contact with those people, and you know, I'm back in contact with that kid. But it was just fascinating to hear somebody tell this story. It was always a weird story, and I'd tell it, nobody would believe it was fucking true. And then this kid comes in, and he tells me the exact same story. So I just like start asking him questions, like, wow, that really. There was something specifically that went on there. Nobody ever tried to do anything sexual with us. My teachers were gay, and they never fucking tried anything. It wasn't anything like you're thinking. But something about 13-year-olds in the 80s up to the early 90s, that was when certain kids woke up. I don't know. The New Age talks about indigo children and that kind of thing, but I don't know if it's the same kind of thing. It's like witchcraft had kind of their own indigo children, I guess. So at any rate, there was a point to all that. I think maybe that was the point. But the self-appointed authority figures from other traditions saying that they have any say-so in other people's traditions or other spirituality. Well, that's a huge thing for me. It seems a huge thing for other people. Why we'd rather do witchcraft and not be Wiccan.
So, I can't even believe how rude these people were.
Yes.
So rude.
Yes.
So rude.
To their elders. My God. Have some respect, you kid. Get off my lawn. I've been drawing pentacles on lawns since before you were an egg.
Well, I guess they're just really that jealous, because
yes.
For me to say he's working, it's like, yeah, you wish you were getting paid to read tarot cards for people, bitch, don't you?
Which I literally, that's what I was doing
yeah.
at that time. I was doing readings. That was reading day. Oh,
just geez. immediate yeah. attacks.
Yeah. A lot of jealousy. A lot of jealousy in the craft. But so that's a huge thing. And just like the dogma and the way a lot of our clergy, and I always say a lot. I don't use absolutes. I don't say all. Not everybody's a dick. But there's a lot of dicks.
Well, a lot of people wouldn't even be that way in person.
Yes.
They're that way behind the safety of their yes. keyboard.
Yes.
Like, if you stood up in front of this exact same group of people and said what you said, nobody would say a fucking word.
Yeah. And I've often said this too. It's like, okay, when it comes time to figure out somebody to lead your coven or lead your group, best policy I've found, ask for volunteers to be the leader. And ask everybody to raise their hand. Whoever doesn't raise their hand, that's your candidate. Those other people are power-mongering shitheads in the making. It's Wittersons. We'll be right back.
Unholy living dead.
Wittershins Radio. I think we were some misfits before that. Go figure. Let's see. So, yeah. That whole big old 2 days of controversy and taking over this person's thread that I wasn't trying to take over, all because I said that I left Wicca for witchcraft.
Yeah.
That's all I said. And for so many people to come in and debate my path and argue with me about my path
shows the overreach. I mentioned, I said you can answer for yourself, but I don't practice Wicca because I don't believe in the read. And then now I'm lumped in with you, and they're just talking shit about both of us.
But, yes, there's that. So there's the dogma, there's the power trips, there's the egomaniacs, there's the stuff that goes when your religion gets too big. That's what happens. We don't have... Well, we do. We do have rapist priests. They're not just raping little boys, but we do have that. That happens within our community. And we do tend to call those out, the Wiccan communities, pagan communities, all the magical communities. So far, I've seen, we're pretty good at jumping all over them and fucking ripping their heads off immediately. But where was I going to go with that? But the read, the Wiccan read. Now, I put out that I disagreed with the read, and one person said, well, the read's just a piece of poetry. Now, immediately I know that this chump is looking at that lovely thing. Eight words of Rick and Reed fulfill, harmony none would do what you will, blah, 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 blah.
It is a nice poem. That's not what we're referring to.
It's a nice poem. It covers a lot of things that, Wiccans do. It's lovely. It's full of, information. Has nothing to do with the Reed except for the first part. And ye harm none. Which and basically means if, roughly, in an old language. Any harm none, do what you will. That's the Wiccan read. It's all it says. Short sentence. Herein lies the rub again, kids. You can't have a short statement of intent. Doesn't work. Remember, do you want Uncle Birch to tell you again when we did a mass spell, which is all over the country, did a mass spell to end the first Gulf War, and the only thing we could agree on in the statement of intent was end the war quickly? Do you want me to tell you that story again? The war ended quickly. It worked. The genocide. The starvation. The no-fly zones, the missile strikes continued all the way up until the next war. Suffering, starving children, women, all that shit continued until the next war. Because our mass statement of intent was too shallow, not broad enough, not covering enough. So, any harm none, do what you will. It's a very short little sentence. Easily undone.
You always have an interesting perspective to bring to these things that I don't always think of.
Like, yes.
You bringing up the fact that they're terrible people because they're Wiccan is spot on.
Wait, what? What did I say?
No, you were saying maybe this is why a lot of people leave Wicca, like based on like their reaction to it.
Yes.
And I didn't even think about it.
Yes.
That.
And not everybody does that. Not everybody does that. A lot of people go solitaire.
Yeah.
And I said, most people that go solitary have been in a group.
Yes.
and I think you need to know both dynamics really. Group dynamics can fuck with a lot of people. And so,
that's a very interesting perspective to bring into the argument.
I
appreciate you bringing that up.
Well, yeah. Well, it's the ultra-feminist witches that have female-only spaces and they're all naked and stuff. They've always said, my entire life, it's a safe space for women. That's why you can't be there with a penis. And I've oft said, especially, watching you over the years, because, Marta's hot, so she brings out some jealous bitches sometimes. What I've noticed is somebody that says that a women's only space is a safe space doesn't know a whole lot of women. Okay? They got some claws. They got some jealousy. In my work... 95% of the time when somebody ends up having a curse on them, it's another woman. And 95% of the time, it's because they're jealous about something. They want their man. They want their looks. They want something that she has that they think that they don't have. And I really don't know of 5% that isn't that, but I just have a problem with absolutes. I don't want to set myself up and have something. I found 1% that are not jealous women. And then you shot up my whole fucking argument. So, you know, I think you probably can't find more than 5%, because my research, 95%. Women altogether, witches themselves, not a safe space. You're totally funny.
I'm so funny.
That's part of the problem, okay? You're hot, you're funny, and you're smart. They got nothing. They got nothing left. You dress well. You got class. Ooh, they got nothing left. They can say, oh, well, she's shallow. She only wants to put on makeup and wear clothes. I'm like, no, that's not going to work either.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I get it. But it sucks that we have to get it. Oh. But yeah, the read, the Wiccan read. First of all, it's too short a sentence. It will be taken out of context and tweaked around all over the place and will lose its full meaning. Short sentences always are. That's why we have language. That's why we have paragraphs and shit, okay? A bumper sticker philosophy, something that will fit on a bumper sticker, will never serve you well. You can have a bumper sticker that says as above, so below, but you probably can't fit, you know, in a font that somebody can read, as above, so below, as without, so within, as the universe, so the soul. Hence, you miss the meaning. You'll be searching for the meaning because the true meaning won't fit on the bumper sticker. The true meaning is not even going to fit in that sentence there. It's larger than that. It's larger than that. But Wicca became a quick fix for a lot of things. You know, it's really short. You don't have to study that much. You learn everything in a year and a day, blah, 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 blah. But then the read, the main rule, even though now, we have dogmas and rulers and power figures and authority figures wielding all of their control all over the place, there was supposed to be one rule. And people back in the day agreed to that rule. All the way back to the 1974 Minneapolis Witch Meet, where they adopted the ways of Wicca here in America. One of the first organized times that I saw the American neo-pagan movement adopt the ways of Wicca. Wicca was not the dominant force in this country before that, in any organized fashion. The only documented time that I could see any documentation of that happening was at the 1974 Minneapolis Witch Meet, where they adopted the principles of Wiccan belief and laid them out. And those Wiccan beliefs may not have been identical to what Gardner and his ilk put out, but they were an American version. And I personally don't give a fuck what went on in England. We got some cool ideas and stuff like that, but I owe no allegiance to anything else born on this soil. I have ancestors from other soils. But here in America, there was a neo-pagan movement. And in Britain, there was the Wiccan movement. And these come together in America and become very different manifestations than they were in England. And you can see when, you know, formally when American neo-pagans adopted those beliefs. And I know of no documentation of adopting those beliefs generally here in America before 1974. But the Wiccan read was one of the things that they adopted and they took on. And I understand PR, pagan relations. It's important. There was nothing but bad press for, you know, a few thousand years, and it was necessary for witches to, every time they went on TV, or Wiccans, to say, you know, we don't hurt people. Our religion forbids us from hurting people. You know, it helps with the Christians when they, you know, they bring up the Ten Commandments that they don't fucking follow.
Yeah.
And, you know, that shall not kill, or shall not blah, blah, blah. And they do it any fucking way. That's religion. It doesn't end up meaning anything at the end of the day, but I understand that it was necessary to say that every time people went on the air. And unfortunately, back during that time, I'll have to go there, it also apparently it seemed necessary for those people to distance themselves from the Satanists, and typically they would say, you know, our religion forbids us from harming anyone. We're not Satanists. We don't eat babies. I've heard that line countless times throughout the 80s, all the way into the 90s, every fucking Wiccan that ever went on any press anywhere, or almost every Wiccan that went on the press, said that, to distance themselves, just to say that they were not Satanists. They're going to imply that Satanists eat babies.
Yeah.
Now, I don't have a problem with the Satanists. Satanists never did nothing to me.
That's the thing, too. Like, if I ever get accused, I always make sure to say, not that there's anything wrong with Satanists, but I happen to not be one.
Yes, yes.
I always say that.
Satanists never debated whether they should suffer me to live. I don't have any problem with Satanists. Satanists never burned any witches at the stake. I don't have any problem with that. I don't need to throw Satanists under the bus and say shit that, you know, that I'm sure is not true, but, you know, say shit that I don't even fucking know about Satanists. But I understand. I understand. It was a PR campaign. I personally will say Wicca was a PR campaign for witchcraft. Not a bad thing, but I'm going to say what it is. Having it molded into this fashion where everything was nice and lovely and it was all about love, just like Jesus, and then nobody could hurt anybody, you know, that was the PR campaign of witchcraft, and it was necessary for the times. I don't see it necessary for these times. We have countless other magical traditions flourishing all around us that are not Wicca. And most don't consider themselves witchcraft. I, you know, I'll call them witchcraft, but they'll probably be mad. But, you know, they're manipulating roots and twigs and things and rocks and stuff to cause change in their world. And that's witchcraft, okay, to me. But some of them are doing it as Catholics. Some of them are doing it as Baptists. Some of them are doing it non-religious whatsoever. I think acupuncture is totally witchcraft. The moving of invisible, the rechanneling of invisible channels of energy through the body to cause change within the body, that's witchcraft. That's witchcraft. And they're using needles.
Yeah.
Needles. I've oft thought that the needles in a voodoo doll are not just about stabbing. They're metal. They generate electricity. The electricity will flow to that point, and magic follows the same laws as electricity. Now, I don't know if voodoo people or people that do that have that theory, but that's often been my theory, and I'm sure my theory is still will work within their theory.
Well, they're usually using voodoo dolls, and I'm not a voodoo practitioner, but my understanding is when they're used, it's for evil purposes.
Yes.
But in acupuncture, we're doing it to heal.
Yes.
But it's the same mechanism.
Yeah, I've seen people do healing rituals with needles on dolls too.
Yeah.
So maybe, you know, I don't know.
There's never an instance where you're going to do acupuncture on somebody to make something work.
Well, I've oft thought after learning about that if you could get an anatomically correct doll with the acupuncture points marked off on it, you could work some crazy shit beyond what the normal doll could ever fucking do, because those channels are mapped out by those points.
I can control somebody's bowel movements.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, I don't know of a good, you know, doll spell to make somebody crap their pants. Or not be able to crap.
Ooh, yeah.
Either one is an equal evil. You know,
I don't know if I could cause not being able to crap.
Oh, okay. Well, you said you can control bowel movements, so.
Yeah, but it's more like making people crap.
Oh, well, that's still handy.
Yeah.
You know, in certain circumstances. But which Wiccans, you know, wouldn't agree. But that's not harming anybody. Yeah. That's kind of just fucking with somebody. Yeah. But
Not that I would do that, people.
But therein lies the rub. I have adhered to those beliefs for a portion of my life, even through a very short career, 3 years in law enforcement. I harmed no one. I struck no one. I wrestled many people into handcuffs and put them in the back of a patrol car and took them to jail. But I did not fight. I did not cause harm. What, cat? I can actually see the cat on the microphone. So the cat won't shut up. But I've lived in that world, the real world. And now we're in the heart of the city. Maybe it feels easier to feel, you know, at peace with everything and everyone, and you never have to harm anyone. You don't have to defend yourself if you're out in the middle of the forest, you know, unless the guys from Deliverance show up. But, you know, here in the heart of the city, no. I feel it. I feel the energies of the city flowing through. You know, a lot of those energies are, you know, violence. It's all around me. It's a violent world. Wish it wasn't, but it is. Pretending it isn't, not going to change anything. Pacifism is the Wiccan read. I am not a pacifist. There are some people that need to be stopped from harming, and it may be necessary to harm them. The Wiccan read doesn't even address that. It's a very short sentence. It's trying to be an all-encompassing. You can shoot it down with shit like that. Somebody's going to come in and kill 50 kids, and I got a gun, and I'm hiding behind them, behind the door. I could harm them. Or I could be a pacifist and let all those children die.
And that's harm by omission.
Harm by omission, yeah. So Wicca doesn't even address shit like that. I think...
Like, they had that... Remember in Enemy at the Gates?
Yeah.
Where the guy had the gun and the other guy was stabbing the other guy and
yeah.
He could have stopped him and he just froze. He eventually shot him in a different scene. But
yeah.
That's harm by omission.
Yes. Yeah. So harm by omission. But there's just... Some people have to be stopped. I remember my first degree oaths. I did oath in my first degree not to harm another, but the second sentence was not to allow another to be harmed if within my power to stop it. Those two oaths clash against each other. They cannot peace. Those two pieces of the oath over time could not peacefully coexist. But a different oath than most people take. You know, we took responsibility to, like, we see somebody getting fucked over by magical or spiritual forces. It's our duty to do something about that. And we might have to fuck up the person on the other end to get them to stop doing that, and we might have to cause harm. That's the real world. And as I said when I got in this argument just the other day, I said, you know, the Wiccan read is the philosophy, is the magical philosophy of pacifism. And I know of two times on this earth that a significant nonviolent pacifist movement has arisen. And that would be Gandhi and Martin Luther King. Both of those people were assassinated.
And they got on your case on that page about they're like, what do you mean?
Yes.
What do you mean? And I was I think what he's saying is that pacifism doesn't work.
Both of the leaders, the most known leaders that I can draw up of nonviolence movements were killed by violence. Gandhi's movement was destroyed. King's nonviolent resistance movement was destroyed. There were still, you know, black power movements. Other stuff took over. You know, a lot of what he fought for went on, but his nonviolent movement, no, it didn't continue significantly. It gave rise to the more militant black rights movements. But Gandhi specifically, his movement was destroyed after his death. We are fed these heroes by the people that control us. Nonviolence is preached to us by the people that control us. They're the ones that keep throwing that out. They're trying to remind us to be nonviolent. Say, no, no, they're violent. They'll be violent. How'd it work out in Tiananmen Square? You know, nonviolence does not thwart violence, and especially massive government violence. It does not work. I am a witch. I need to see my practices reflected in nature or symbolically in the world around me, or they're not real. If I don't see them reflected in nature, they are not laws. I don't see harm none, do what you will, reflected in nature. A lot of people equate the Wiccan reed with the threefold law, that which you send out will come back to you threefold. I do not see that in nature. If I throw a pebble into a pond, the ripples will eventually reach back to the source that they originated from, but are they amplified threefold? No. And there are waves coming from different directions, but they are so minimized from the waves that went out, I do not see the threefold law in nature. I've done the math. I've watched all of the different waves that'll come back together at that source are minuscule in comparison to the big splash that went out of that pebble hitting the water. While I do see that, you know, what you send out comes back, does it come back amplified threefold? No. I do not see that reflected in nature, and I see none of the laws of physics that state that. When energy is sent out and it comes up against resistance, energy slows down. Energy follows the path of least resistance. So the resistance of all of the water molecules going along and bouncing off the wall slows it down and minimizes the force that came back to you. So yes, what you send out does come back to you, but is it amplified threefold? Absolutely not. There's nothing in the laws of nature that say that. Therein lies the rub. I'm a parent. Twice now. My first one grew all the way up. She's 21 years old, so I hope I did something right there. I hope she turns out to be okay. On my second time now, raising my kids. Where was I going with that? Kids.
You have kids.
Have kids. What did I say before that? Yeah.
You have kids. You raised the first one.
I was on a roll.
I don't know where you're going with that.
I looked at the cat. The cat threw me off because the cat's name is Sabo.
Yep.
He sabotaged me.
Black Sabo.
Yeah.
So you have kids.
Talk about the threefold law.
First one's 21. You hope she turns out okay. Second one, your second one. Wow. I have no idea where you were going with that.
I have no idea. I got distracted and I totally lost it. That happens. It'll come back. So talking about the threefold law. Laws of nature. Come back. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know where
and
I was
the pebble
going.
Pebble bouncing.
Yeah, well, no, it's not bouncing. I'm not skipping rocks. God.
You're
That's
not?
What you got out of it?
Yeah.
Oh my God, Wittershins, the twisted approach to the left-hand path, which we never said in the beginning.
Wittershins.
All right, so having a good time. We're ranting about the threefold law and stuff. Yeah, herein lies the rub. The rub is, I don't know. All right, we're gonna play a song and hopefully I'll remember.
Yeah, you'll remember your rub.
Wittershins, I'm gonna remember my rub. Wittershins. Radio for your spiritual side. The twisted approach to the left-hand path, which we didn't say at the beginning of the show. Yeah. I remember, I think. I'm a father.
Oh, you remember.
I remember.
Okay, don't look at the cat.
I'm not looking at the cat. Get the cat away from me. you know, I spent most of my life, nonviolent. Like I said, with the whole cop thing and shit. But then I had a kid. Now I have two kids. And I learned this dark beast that lurks within that'll rip your fucking head off if you even think about endangering one of my children. And I never knew that. I even for self-preservation, I never knew such a violent beast lurking within me until I had a child. And then after two children, it's like amplified.
I love that about you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like amplified fucking tenfold. It's like I Wiccan read or not, if you even think about it, I will be ripping your entrails out through your Gulliver and stomping on them and lighting them on fire and dancing upon them on the street. I can't do the Wiccan read, man. And I don't know how anybody that was ever a parent ever thought they could. It's pagan. It's nature. It's wired into the species, all of the species of the planet, protecting the young. Ultimate. Any parent of any species will give their life to save their young, and will definitely take lives, all the lives possible, to protect their young. That's pagan. That's nature. Now, therein is part of the problem is Gerald Gardner, when assembling Wicca into the form that he put it into, you know, he absorbed paganism into it. And that's what, you know, probably why over here in America, you know, neo-paganism and Wicca would, you know, integrate so well. But it was a larger thing than Wicca, because Wicca had these, you know, these nice rules. Nature doesn't. Nature has laws. Nature has laws of nature, and nature is harsh, and nature is cruel. And nature is wonderful, and I love nature, and, you know, I worship nature. I'm you know, still a pagan. I don't really see how they blended together that well. You know, this fluffy harm none kind of thing while being trying to create this nature worshiping religion. I don't even see how that worked out that well back then. But what do you have to say? I've been ranting.
No, you're good at ranting. That's what you do.
You're good at ranting.
No, you rant. I write. That's how we do it.
All right. Well, right now I need you to rant. So
I've been writing all day. Funny stuff.
You've been writing band names. Funny stuff.
Well, you know, sometimes I just have to amuse myself all day.
You gotta laugh.
You gotta laugh, especially when you're feeling craptastic.
Yeah.
You gotta
laugh. It's our humor that sustains us as a people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Let's see. So we talked about Wicca Reed.
Tupac Shakur.
Tupac Shakur. But, so yeah, growing more and more, you know, outside of just the people leaving Wicca for just witchcraft on its own, there are other traditions out there that are witchcrafty kind of, you know, hoodoo's huge now, conjure's huge now. I found it, a lot of what I was taught by Judith Dufresne, under the guise of the DCW, which, you know, was, you know, either Appalachian or Ozark fucking hill magic. I forget which one it is. It's what we now know as hoodoo. You know, a lot of that stuff. You know, I grew up with, you know, high John roots and shit. a lot of that stuff just was so integrated back in the day. And one of the only recipe books you could get was from a guy, Herman Slater, who was running around, you know, getting all these hoodoo recipes. So a lot of the original recipes and a lot of the the recipes you could get for witchcraft turned out to be, you know, being stolen from hoodoo by Herman Slater.
Doesn't Cat Ironwood hate Herman Slater?
She does, although she posts all of his...
I don't remember why, but she got shit.
Yeah, she did. She did. Because, well, you know, ultimately his recipes competed with her recipes, so I don't know. I don't know how it all happened, but yeah, a lot of... when I look back at a lot of those recipes that I grew up on, we now know them as hoodoo. We now know some of them as conjure. We know shit before. Nobody knew where it was. It's folk magic. It's the magic of the folk. The witches were integrating. We didn't know exactly where it came from, but you know, now we're in the information age. But there's just so many other things out there other than Wicca. And then some Wicca has just gotten so ridiculous, you know, like unicorn Wicca and shit. although I do not agree with the level of control that the British traditional Wiccans try and enforce out there. That if you are not initiated through a strain that goes back to Gardner, the Farrars, or Sanders, you're not really Wiccan. That's part of the huge problem why I will not call myself Wiccan. I studied it. I read it. Did you read Gardner? Maybe you didn't. I sure the fuck did. I read everything before that. You know, I read all of Sanders. I read all of the Farrars, all of Gardner. Nothing like that came from Gardner. Gardner exercised no control over it. In the, I believe it was 2001, there was some malcontent that published Gardner's Book of Shadows on the internet. And we just happened to have a guy at our shop whose job was to peruse the internet looking for obscure occult texts and print them out before they could be lost. We had this crazy reference library, a lot of it lost over the years, just, you know, stuff we printed out. Phil Hine, man, we had a whole library of Phil Hine that you can find on the internet, but we had it in print. And we printed up Gardner's Book of Shadows before it got deleted about probably about 2 weeks later. And it's exactly what a Book of Shadows should look like. It had notes upon notes, stuff crossed out, stuff written above it, stuff written below it. In the liner notes was Crowley. A lot of Crowley. He clearly was admitting what he borrowed from Crowley and categorized what he borrowed from which sources to create his Wicca. In very recent years, a Book of Shadows called Gardner's Book of Shadows came out, looked at it, bullshit, didn't even look like a Book of Shadows, let alone Gardner's Book of Shadows. And I believe the one I saw back in 2001 and perused for a great many months was Gardner's Book of Shadows. Everything in there made sense. Some of this other shit that I was handed later, professing to be Gardner's Book of Shadows, no, it did make sense. I'm from an old school of witchcraft where it makes sense. It's got to make sense. You may have to wrap your head around a weird way that it makes sense, but if it don't make sense, it ain't magic. It ain't witchcraft. I've ranted long enough on that. Do you have anything to rant on right there before we go to another break?
No.
You need to follow us, bitches.
Wow.
Listen, on Spreaker, there's a button. It says follow. You got to follow the shows that you like. Because sometimes We'll go on the air randomly. There have been times we went on the air late. There was one time we were on our way home way late, and we went on the air in the car on the way home.
We almost didn't go on the air tonight.
Yeah.
We had possible plans for tonight, and which meant means we would have gone on another night.
Yeah.
I don't even know which other night. But, yeah, some other night.
And so usually, like, if we have to do that, if we have to not be on the air on our scheduled night, we'll be on the air on another night. But unless you're on one of our Facebook pages, you won't know it unless you press follow. Follow, 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 follow. All of the shows on Spreaker. Candela, it's 12 o'clock somewhere with Candela Kumbisa. In the Streets, Beverly Smith. Ambrosine Laguerre does a show, but I don't think she's ever had a schedule. Has just popped up here and there. If you follow it, you'll know when she's on.
I'm trying to understand the difference between Spreaker and iHeartRadio.
Yeah.
Can you just be on iHeartRadio and follow the show? Or do you have to be on Spreaker to follow the show?
What we really need to do is... Oh, maybe we'll do this later in the show. You have the iHeartRadio app, right?
Yes, I do.
So you look up our show and see if you see us live streaming, because I don't know that. I know we're live streaming on Spreaker.
All right, let's see. Opening the app.
Shortly after the show, we will appear on YouTube as, you know, an audio file.
Okay, so...
got to search for us. And we're on iHeartRadio.
Podcast, right? Wait. Confirm with Touch ID.
Okay, she's confirming with her Touch ID.
Okay, so... okay.
And, of course, the iHeartRadio app's asking her a bunch of crap.
Oh,
making her update the terms
crap.
And conditions. She's going to agree. Okay. I would just search Wittershins. That's how I found it.
Well, your purchase was successful?
What purchase?
No. What?
You would have had to put in a password.
No, if I have my finger thing, I don't have to put in the password. What purchase?
Oh, my God.
What purchase?
All right, well, hopefully iHeartRadio's
not... Do not use iHeartRadio. Use Spreaker. This is bullshit.
Yeah, I'm not sure what we just did on iHeartRadio. All right, well, we're going to have to figure it out.
Oh, God. Really,
That's... Yeah. That's why... Yeah.
Apple, your subscription confirmation. Okay, I guess I'm subscribing to iHeartRadio.
Oh. Purchase. What does that mean?
It's $5.99 every month.
What?
All right. Well, I can deal with that, but...
Okay. Well, okay. I guess there's a subscription.
Okay, well, now I have a subscription, so now, motherfucker, I better be able to do whatever I want.
So, wait a minute.
What?
Wait a minute. So...
Sign required?
So, we're broadcasting on iHeartRadio, and they're making money?
I don't know what my...
Well, I thought that I listened to us. Maybe you're probably getting iHeartRadio without commercials for your $5 or something like that. But I think you can listen to the content without it. But we're on iHeartRadio, and I'm not sure yet if we live broadcast on there or if it comes up after we go off the air. Because like the YouTube, I know the YouTube shows up as an audio file on my video channel, probably maybe a half hour after we go off the air. And then we're a couple other places too. I can't think of where all we are broadcasting right now.
This is bullshit.
But this is bullshit. I just want you to know that. We're going to cut to a musical break.
Yeah.
And I like this one. For my Polaro people, Dig Upper Bones by the Misfits.
Any place is where she'll be. any place to see you from. Lies and secrets become your world. Anytime, anywhere, sticks me away. And that climbs up the steps one by one to give you the rose that's been earned by her.
Like the blood on my
Bad Religion on Wittershins, where Marta has been doing battle with iHeartRadio. I'm not sure how far she's gotten, but yeah, be careful. Apparently, it's really easy to subscribe to some crap.
It.
Okay, you canceled it.
Yeah.
Was it like a pop-up they accidentally hit, or how did it do it that? How did it sell you
something
that?
Something happened, and it just wanted, you know, my fingerprint.
Yeah.
So I thought it was, I just needed it for iHeartRadio, so I didn't have to put in my password. But I guess it was something to buy something.
Ah.
But they weren't going to bill me until October, and I already canceled it.
Okay. Yeah, because I know I've listened to us on iHeartRadio without paying anything.
Okay, I'm not even. So maybe it's have like a phone.
Well, maybe it's like a non-commercial. Maybe you don't get commercials. I think you get commercials on the other version. I don't know. I don't know who's getting paid for the commercials. But we're on iHeartRadio. We're on YouTube. We're on a bunch of different formats. Yeah. You know about that?
No.
Yeah, it uploads like an audio file on my video channel.
Okay.
It looks like a little graph of audio all the way down. And we get a decent amount of listeners to the audio file on YouTube. And people are always asking me, do I podcast? It's like, well, that's where they ask. So they're like, people are listening to YouTube like it's a podcast. So it works out. You can download it here on Spreaker, too. You just got to set up an account. Follow. But you can set up an account by using your Facebook information with like two or three clicks, man.
It's like National Cheeseburger Day.
It's National Cheeseburger Day. Marta's telling us for some reason.
Dinner.
Oh, yeah. I think we're going to have cheeseburgers soon or something. My God, 6:39?
Yeah.
Where did the time go? We've talked about not a whole lot. We can read.
Yeah.
Don't like it. Dogma?
I don't like it. It's like,
self-pointed
if other people
figures.
Like it and they want to live it, that's cool. I'm not going to pick up my pitchfork like these assholes.
Yeah, some people need that. But Wicca or witchcraft was never meant to be ruled by a bunch of egotistical fuckheads. Gardner didn't plan it that way, and if he did, I would have said, fuck you, Gardner. Witchcraft was meant to be witchcraft, and the religion of witchcraft, Wicca, was meant to be a response to the dogmatic religions and the male-dominated religions that dominated the world. Not supposed to be like them. There's just too much that's like them, and I don't want to be like you. So not only am I not using Wicca, I'm a warlock. And that pisses a lot of you off, too.
Oh, yeah. I think one of them on that page made some comment like a noob would make about warlock.
Yeah, exactly. And outside of that, I understand the necessity of making witchcraft a religion, but witchcraft is not always religious. Witchcraft is sometimes spiritual for a lot of people. I haven't abandoned my gods and goddesses. I can't really. I'm connected to them at this point. But it's not all religious. Some of it's spiritual. Unfortunately, and I think a lot of my friends and colleagues might have missed this part, spirituality is not covered under the Constitution of the United States. It's not covered in the Bill of Rights. Religion is. That's why Wicca had to become a federally recognized religion. A lot of the spiritualities that we're involved in, and even other religions, like Palo. I don't know if Palo is federally recognized. I don't know if you could invoke your religious rights. I don't know.
Well, I think
do you have to be federally recognized to invoke your religious rights? I don't know how that works.
I think you aren't necessarily going to get in trouble for sacrifice if you could, you know, if you tell them that it's for religious purposes.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Huh.
I don't know about having in Fumbe, though, unless you get it from, like, bone room or whatever.
Yeah. All right. You're listening to Wittershins, and we are just talking about Witchcraft Without Wicca. Witchcraft Without Wicca is an upcoming course on my my Gumroad channel, and it's kind of the way I work on stuff like this. I like to speak about some of it. I like to work it out out on the internet. I like to start debates with some people about that out on the internet. I like to thank the people on the pagan and or Wiccan and pagan channel or wherever I started that argument. I like to thank you for helping me work this kind of stuff out, because the whole reason for that and for the show is so I couldn't work out, you know, some of the things I have to say and some of my material, you know, just kind of a sounding board to bounce ideas off of before I put out the course that people will then pay to download. Witchcraft Without Wicca course will be coming out hopefully within the next couple weeks on gumroad.com/witchschool. That's gum, like gum on your shoe, and road, like the road you drive on. And witch school, which of course is S-K-E-W-L, W-I-T-C-H, S-K-E-W-L. It'll be coming out, and it's going to be a series, couple hours a session. I'm not sure how many sessions, but something I'm working on right now. And thank you for helping me work on some of it right now. We got a ghetto bird closing in a circle nearby us, so it's going to be really loud. So now's a perfect time to rock out the end of the show. Thank you for joining us at Wittershins. You can find us at wittershinsradio@gmail.com. You can find us on several different Facebooks. You can find me at Uncle Birch, Unity of Wicca and Witchcraft, or you can find me by many of my other names and Marta too. You can find me on YouTube at FreakPhil1309. That's FreakPhil and the numbers 1309. Catch us every Tuesday, 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, unless we announce otherwise. And then we'll pop up whenever the hell we want. And you will wish you had signed up on Spreaker, made an account, and pressed follow. Okay. Thanks for joining us, y'all. See you next week.
I come down the steps. I slip on the ice. Santa Claus been looking. Who's been naughty? Who's been nice? I'm looking for one thing real tonight. And Jesus, he comes. Down.
A new age of reason, brain treason to trick the mind. What good is searching if nothing's there to find? We arrive at this place of no return, my brothers, only to discover that our minds have led us away. So we'll be right back.
subservient and don't know what's perspective.
Full, now an empty vase with the blossoms on his early grave. Walk away, me boy, walk away, me boy, and by morning we'll be free. Wipe that golden tear from your mother dear and raise what's left of the flag for me. Then the rosary beads, count them, one, two, three, fell apart as they hit the floor. In a garb of black, we must pay respect to the colour we're born to mourn. Walk away, me boys, walk away, me boys, by morning we'll be wipe that golden tear from your mother dear, and raise what's left of the flag for me.